Hey, 42 here. In 1806, a chicken from the English town of Leeds laid an egg. That wouldn't usually be big news by anyone's standards, but this egg was different. It had the words, "Christ is coming," inscribed on it. More eggs followed with similar prophetic messages on them, and locals began taking notice. Talk of an impending judgment day began to spread, causing local alarm before someone discovered the words on the egg were, astonishingly, not put there by some magical power, but rather by a con artist and suspected witch called Mary Bateman, who etched words on the eggs with acid before sticking them back up where they came from. Ouch. Of course, this foul story is not the only time people have got excited about the end of the world. Halley's Comet is visible from Earth every 75 years or so, but in 1910, it was expected to pass closer to our big blue planet than usual. People seemed quite excited about seeing the comet up close, until some scientists announced that the comet's tail, which contains a deadly gas called cyanogen, would probably wrap around us, snuffing out all life on Earth. Mass hysteria ensued, and people did what they always seem to do when they think it's Armageddon: buy loads of crap. Popular items included gas masks, comet-protecting umbrellas, bottled air, and anti-comet pills. Some people hid in wells, others in caves. A group of people in Oklahoma even tried to sacrifice a virgin to guarantee their safety. Better safe than sorry. Another end of days prediction came in 1997, when 39 members of the Heaven's Gate UFO cult in California declared the human race was soon to be recycled by the alien beings who had created it. In order to escape the impending suffering on Earth, the cultists ended their own lives in a mass suicide, freeing their souls to be collected by a spaceship that was apparently passing Earth in the tail of another comet, this time Hale-Bopp. Then, of course, there was the 21st of December 2012, the date supposedly identified by the Maya calendar as the end of time. Apparently, 10% of people worldwide thought there was a good chance the Maya prediction was absolutely correct. Maybe you were one of them. But it turned out the whole thing was a big misunderstanding of Maya texts and mythology. Of course, the Maya were also known to take ritual enemas of alcohol mixed with hallucinogenic substances, so that may have had something to do with it. Shove enough LSD up anyone's arse and they'll start predicting the end of days sooner or later. In total, there have been more than 150 recorded predictions of an impending annihilation, 12 of which are attributed to one preacher named Harold Camping, who, quite logically, seems to have assumed that if you predict the end of the world often enough, it's only a matter of time before you're going to be correct. Clearly, if you're watching this video, we can safely assume none of these various predictions have come true just yet. Not unless my content's trending in the great big campsite in the sky, anyway. These days, the word apocalypse has come to mean the destruction of our world, but originally, it actually meant the revealing of divine mysteries. The word's connection with the end of times came about as a result of the Book of Revelation, the last book of the New Testament in the Christian Bible. It's a wild read, filled with torture, death and destruction, multi-headed beasts, plagues, and a woman with a tattoo on her forehead reading, "Babylon the Great, the mother of prostitutes, and the abominations of the earth." That must have been one hell of a forehead. The Book of Revelation can be read in different ways, as a symbolic account of a rather awful past, a fairly horrible present, or a brutally unpleasant future. But that last interpretation tends to be the most popular these days. Many Christians read the horror story in Revelations as an account of what the last days on earth will be like before Jesus returns and everyone faces the final judgment. And a big player in that drama is the Antichrist. If you do happen to be the Antichrist, you'd probably want to hide your internet activity from the big man upstairs, or the government. They probably wouldn't appreciate you Googling how to end all of mankind. And no VPN I've used is faster or easier than Surfshark. Surfshark runs on any device anywhere, and it's packed full of features such as industry-leading uncrackable encryption, IP and DNS leak protection, an internet kill switch if your VPN drops out, and 24/7 customer support. And really importantly, they maintain a strict no-logs policy. Surfshark's network of 3,200 servers in over 65 countries runs 100% on RAM. So they couldn't log your data even if they wanted to. By using Surfshark VPN, you can stay anonymous and secure online. Personally, I'm not looking to end all of mankind, but I do use Surfshark for slightly more humane ends, to watch all that juicy Netflix content from other countries such as the US that's usually blocked here in the UK. I'm offering my audience an 83% discount plus 3 extra months for free if you click the special link in the description below. Don't miss out, guys. Whether you're a believer or not, you've probably heard of this guy. He's Christ's direct opposite and Satan's son, so it's safe to say he's probably a nasty piece of work. Because the Antichrist is prophesied to take Christ's place ahead of Judgment Day, it's widely understood the arrival of the Antichrist signifies the end of days, which is why so many people are constantly trying to figure out who the hell he is. Popular candidates so far have been Hitler, Napoleon, Barack Obama, Ronald Reagan, Donald Trump, John F. Kennedy, okay, pretty much every US president, Bill Gates, Danny DeVito, Prince William of England, King Juan Carlos of Spain, a boy called Adam who lives in Tadfield, England, various popes, and in a plot twist I certainly didn't see coming, Jesus Christ himself. The problem is, there isn't actually any mention of the Antichrist in the Book of Revelation, and hardly any reference to him in the Bible at all. It seems most of what we think we know about the Son of Satan comes from some inventive storytelling and creative Bible interpretation over the last 2,000 years. For example, the Book of Revelation famously refers to the four horsemen of the apocalypse, who arrive on earth as the world prepares for judgment, however one prepares for judgment. Riding on a white horse, the first horseman is conquest. The second on a red horse is war. The third horseman on a black horse is famine. And the final horseman riding on a pale horse is death. For almost two millennia, the established view was that the white horseman represented Christ. But that changed in 1866 when self-styled religious leader Carl Friedrich Zimpel suggested the white horse actually carried the Antichrist, who he thought was probably Napoleon Bonaparte. Despite the fact Zimpel went on to lose a little credibility when he incorrectly predicted Christ's second coming on three different occasions, his ideas lived on. The white horse riding Antichrist theory made it to the United States at the end of the 19th century and is still popular today, 20 centuries after the Book of Revelation is thought to have been written. In some ways, it's understandable the Antichrist figure has been embellished with apocalyptic powers and given a starring role in the annihilation of existence, because the alternative is, quite frankly, a little dull.
Oh.
The first suggestion of an Antichrist-like character was presented in the Hebrew Bible's Book of Daniel, which is thought to have been written in 167 BC. The book spoke of a powerful oppressor who would deny the Hebrew God and persecute the Jews. But in what would become a bit of a tradition in the Bible, this mysterious figure is never mentioned by name, leaving his identity open to interpretation. Having said that, most scholars agree Daniel wasn't talking about a future agent of Armageddon at all, but was instead making a thinly veiled allusion to Antiochus IV Epiphanes, the Greek ruler of Palestine who seemed intent on eradicating Judaism. In the New Testament, we find the first and second epistles of John, the only two books in the Christian Bible to actually feature the word Antichrist. The term is used in two different ways here. The first is basically a catch-all phrase that can be applied to anyone who happens to be opposed to Christ. Whilst the second is closer to the meaning most of us associate with the word Antichrist today. A great destroyer who will one day come to Earth and give us humans a good telling off. As I mentioned, the Book of Revelation, which is thought to have been written in the 1st century AD, around the same time as the first and second epistles of John, doesn't talk about the Antichrist directly. But there is quite a lot of talk of a coming persecutor. As we saw with the Book of Daniel, many Bible scholars believe this mysterious figure was not the son of Satan, but a very real person who lived around the time the Revelations was written. Emperor Nero of Rome. A rather delightful chap who is rumoured to have used Christians as human torches to light his garden during the night. And this connection was more than just idle speculation. You see, it's also in the Book of Revelation that John refers to his shady persecutor as both the beast from the abyss and the beast from the sea. And it's the second of these creatures that gives us another common Antichrist touchstone, the number of the beast, 666. Interestingly enough, this is not a random figure, nor need it have anything to do with a future Antichrist. The Book of Revelation was originally written in ancient Greek and Hebrew, languages whose number systems are based on letters, similar to how Roman numerals are. That means the letters of any word in these languages can be added up to generate a numerical value. The number of the beast line in Revelations happens to be written in Hebrew, and it turns out that the numerical value of the words Nero Caesar in Hebrew add up to, you guessed it, 666. Writing in code like this makes sense. The person who wrote the Book of Revelation was named John, but there's a lot of debate about which John. Traditionally, the author was believed to be John the Apostle, writer of the Gospel of John and one of Jesus' original disciples. But Christian scholars noticed there were major differences in style, religious outlook, and language fluency between the Gospel of John and the Book of Revelation. The person now believed to be the most likely author of the book was a man called John the Presbyter, who happened to be banished by the Roman authorities to the Greek island of Patmos, the place where the Book of Revelation was written during a time of great Roman persecution. In 70 AD, 60,000 Roman soldiers invaded Jerusalem to crush an armed Jewish revolt before burning down the Great Temple and leaving the city in ruins. It was a massive psychological blow to the early Christians who were expecting Jesus to return to them at any moment and smite down the Roman Empire who brought about his death decades before. John likely wrote the Book of Revelations as a stirring call to his fellow Christians, encouraging them to keep faith in their religion in the face of hardship under cruel Roman rule. Of course, such a communication could not have been written in plain English, as the Roman authorities would have stamped it out. So, it's believed he used a figurative language of revelation to hide numerous codes and metaphors other Christians would understand. But without that context, those who came later took all the blood and thunder of the Book of Revelation and the talk of some kind of mysterious persecutor to be a warning about the end of the world and the individual who would bring it about, the Antichrist. And this is where the Antichrist story starts to get creative. Around the year 954, it appears Queen Gerberga of Saxony became so anxious about the state of the world, she started to get a little concerned the last days might be just around the corner. With precious little to go on in the Bible, the queen asked a monk by the name of Adso of Montier Adur for some more information about the Antichrist. And Adso obliged with a letter to the queen that became known as the Little Book on the Antichrist. That sounds like a nice read. In it, the monk combined his own ideas with commentary from various religious writers who'd been active during the 800 to 900 years that had passed since early Christians put the finishing touches to the New Testament. The book was a hit during the Middle Ages and became the go-to medieval reference text for anyone wanting the lowdown on the Last Judgment. According to monk Adso and his fellow writers, the Antichrist was a literal person who would essentially be Christ's opposite in every way. Jesus was born of a virgin through immaculate conception. So, the Antichrist would be born of a whore through conception by some awful spirit. Christ's father was a man, so the Antichrist's father would probably be a demon. A man would also be possible, but only if he was a satanic craphead. Christ was born in Bethlehem, the Antichrist would be born in Babylon, and so on. Eventually, the Antichrist would go to Jerusalem, build up a massive following thanks to some impressive miracles and a few raisings of the dead here and there. But he'd also persecute Christians horribly for 3.5 years before being eventually defeated by the newly returned Christ, or the Archangel Michael, if Christ is too busy playing golf in heaven. One man who disagreed with this storyline was a 12th century monk called Joachim of Fiore. Instead of one future Antichrist, Joachim suggested a timeline of past and future Antichrists, ending with a final Antichrist called Gog. This view caught on, and towards the end of the Middle Ages, many people believed they were either surrounded by the Antichrist predecessors, or the big evil Gog himself. And so started the long-standing tradition of suspecting any leader you didn't like of being the son of perdition. Candidates included Holy Roman Emperor Frederick II, Pope John XXII, and later Russian Tsar Peter the Great. In the 16th century, the man who catalyzed the formation of the Protestant Church, Martin Luther, popularized a more general view that the Antichrist was not one person, but rather a collective body of evil. A particular pope, for example, was not the Antichrist. The leadership of the Catholic Church was. Today, both approaches are still popular. On the one hand, the Antichrist is a particular person, usually in our presence already, scheming to bring about the end of days. On the other hand, the Antichrist is a faceless evil, a secret organization of sorts, planning to mark everyone on the planet with the sign of the beast before ruling over the earth. Either way, it seems the Antichrist can be pretty much whoever or whatever you want it to be. So, thanks for watching. Thanks again to Surfshark for sponsoring this video. Don't forget to check them out using the link below.